It is my pleasure to present Dr. Lenore Terr. Dr. Terr went to medical school, did her psychiatric training, and her child psychiatry fellowship at the University of Michigan. She's currently a clinical professor of psychiatry at the University of California, San Francisco, where she also has a private practice. She has received many awards and honors and has published extensively throughout her career. Dr. Terr is an international expert in childhood trauma. She is here today to present Jay Sandusky's legacy, the etiology and trajectory of PTSD across the life course. Please help me welcome Dr. Lenore Terr.
Thank you so much for inviting me here. This is one of the real treasures of the Americas and also of the world, and it's just such a pleasure to be here in New Mexico. I had a wonderful morning with the residents and the fellows in child and adolescent psychiatry. And today I'm going to talk to you about Jerry Sandusky's legacy, the remains of childhood trauma in adult life. It's going to be sort of an unusual talk in that I am going to present to you 8 people and a 9th phone call that I received during the time that Jerry Sandusky was on trial. Jerry Sandusky was one of the coaches at Penn State. And as you know, he sexually abused a number of boys who were in a program that he sponsored through Penn State. And that not only did those boys complain over the years about being abused, but they were observed, or at least one of them was observed by somebody else. And these boys eventually came to be known as the Sandusky Eight. Interestingly enough, I saw 8 patients, some of whom were ongoing patients and a couple of whom were new patients, and I received a call from a very, very old research duo, 2 research subjects, and all of this happened at about the same time, not exactly the same time, but in June and July of last year, just when Sandusky was on trial and then waiting for his sentencing. Did they come or did I hear from them because of Sandusky? I doubt it. Many of them were seeing me on occasion from time to time whenever they needed me. But all of them, these 8 that I saw in my practice, plus an extra one which I will tell you about, so there are 9. And then it turned out that Sandusky's own stepson at the same time stepped out and said that he too had been abused by Sandusky, so there was an extra. There was a 9 in the Sandusky case as well as in my caseload, all of whom were adults who had been sexually or physically or otherwise traumatized when they were very young or when they were young. So let me give you a rundown of who they were. And of course, their names are disguised. Some of their professions are mildly changed, although not terribly changed. And some of their circumstances, just to keep them disguised, are also slightly changed. But the gist of their stories and what happened to them will not be changed. So I have done a number of studies over the years. And one of them was the Chowchilla school bus study. What happened at Chowchilla was that in July of 1976, 26 kids who were aged 5 to 14 were kidnapped from their school bus by 3 men with guns. They and their school bus driver were ordered onto blackened vans, which had been driven down into a slough. And I know that you as New Mexicans know what a slough is, but it is a dry creek bed. They were transferred into blackened vans. They were driven around for 11 hours all over California, as it turns out. And then in the middle of the night at about 3 in the morning, they were ordered into that hole. They were told to give their names, they were to give a personal item that belonged to them, and then sent down into that hole, which was really a moving van that had been buried months before in a rock quarry by the three young men. These kids amazingly affected their own escape 16 hours after being put into the hole. And they did this by climbing into the area that they had first descended into, and then trying to knock the roof off of it, and then trying to knock all the dirt that had layered, had been thrown on top of it to bury them alive. What the actual motivations of these three guys were has never been known. The rumor in town the first year after it happened was that they had done it as revenge for a speeding ticket they had gotten in town, that they were going to steal the town's kids. It's very much a Pied Piper kind of experience, but these 26 kids emerged from that buried moving van with only a few urinary tract infections, a few scratches and bruises, and completely physically intact. So this was the first large group, and it was a large group that had all experienced exactly the same thing, not a whole group of other things, and had all gone through what was horrible separation from their families, not knowing whether they would live or die, not knowing what was being done to them, and a traumatic event that was entirely emotionally traumatic and not physically traumatic. There were no legs cut off, there were no horrible injuries, as you can tell. So some of what I'm going to talk to you today about will have to do with Chowchilla, which happened in 1976, and so it's 37-something years since then. I did a one-year study within the first year, and then I did a comparison group and this group at 4 to 5 years, and that was the last that I did. But I kept in informal contact with some of the kids, and when they went through various phases of their lives, some of them came to San Francisco, even though it's far from Chowchilla, and did visit me once or twice to see what we could work out about these new phases that they were going through. Now the Jerry Sandusky story. He was sexually interested in boys, and over the years, some of these boys reported what was being done to them. Some of them only came forward when they were men, and it was already known what had happened. At the trial, these eight boys testified, or testimony was taken about them by another observer. And Sandusky's son, who was an adoptive son, waited in the wings as number nine to testify if necessary. This was probably enough of a threat that Sandusky himself did not testify at his trial, never gave any reasons for what happened. The only interview that he ever had was with Bob Costas, who was a sports announcer, and in that one, he acted as though he was naive to these problems. So he was found guilty in June, at the end of June of last year. He was led off to jail, and his sentencing did take place on October 9th of this year. So my office story is eight patients, one phone call that matches the Sandusky narrative. Two of the kids were from Chowchilla, from 1976. Two of the kids were a sister and a brother who were both abused in the same babysitting situation in their town, far from San Francisco. They are now in their 40s. They are very professional, very adept people, and they are 5 years apart. The boy, who was the older of the two, never spoke to anybody about what had been done to him, and therefore did not protect his sister from having gone through the same experience 5 years later. And this babysitting group, who babysitted numbers of children, were indiscriminate about whether they sexually bothered boys or girls, and so both of them got sexually abused. One of them who came in during one of my eight is the wild child who comes once a month, who I have written about in the American Academy of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry Journal. I have followed her since she was close to 3 years old. She was terribly abused up to the age of 13 months old and then removed because her sister, abused in the same way as she, died from the abuse. And so when the police came in to pick up a three-week-old body of a baby who was being abused up to 3 weeks, they found this other 13-month-old and put her into foster care. And I've seen her once a month since she's around three. One of the patients in my group of eight, or nine if you want to look at it that way, is a girl who was raped in her first year of college as a freshman by a boy who was a senior on the football team. Not only did he rape her at his fraternity house, but he hung her out the window from a third floor story and threatened to throw her out, calling her all kinds of names and physically completely overpowering her. This happened about a year and a half before she came to see me. She had seen no psychiatrist about it, although she was under psychiatric care at another university. She was under care for ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and was receiving medication, but had never told the psychiatrist what happened to her. Another one of the patients in my eight is an 83-year-old woman who I write about in Too Scared to Cry, who was a child of the beaches of San Francisco during the war, and before the age of five was multiply sexually abused by a number of characters who we have never been able to figure out who they were, probably sailors and stuff. Her family ran a carnival concession on the beach of San Francisco, which at that time had a whole carnival going on during the war. And she was just let to wander around their concession and got into all kinds of problems with men coming after her. One is a male poet of age 70, rather famous poet, who used to dance during the war at a bar to lure men for his mother, who was a prostitute. She would have him put on little dances, and he would get all kinds of attention, and then she, the man, and the little boy would go up to whatever room, and he observed all kinds of sexual carryings on. He went into foster care when he was around 5 years old, and he was multiply attacked sexually by men in the foster care system. He then went into a full-time institution. At that time, they had orphanages and things for kids who were not getting along well in foster care. And he finally got himself into a very famous university because he was such a good singer and such a good teller of stories and such a good poet that he was able to get into one of the major universities and has had a major career as a literary person. And the final one is a woman professor who has had a series of horrible dreams about men, has never married, and was finally told by her mother, who was close to death, that it was a terrible thing that happened to you before you were five with that man across the street. She had gone to a therapist who told her that she was having false memories and that none of this was true. And she wanted to get a second opinion from me and showed up at the time of the Jerry Sandusky trial. So those are the people, the nine characters that I saw, and I will give you more details about them as we go along. But my questions were, what does a guy like Jerry Sandusky leave with people in the long run? So what is the legacy of an abuser or traumatizer? And the answer is that you see in adults immediate behaviors that reflect what happened to them, and you see long-standing life patterns that reflect what happened to them. And that you can see these both immediate behaviors and life patterns no matter what diagnosis you give them, whether or not you decide that on top of that they have depression, or on top of that they have a personality disorder, or that on top of that they have another anxiety disorder. That no matter what diagnosis they have, or no diagnosis, you can still see the patterns in adulthood that are based on early trauma. So let's look at the short-term ones first. And then before going on to the long-term or the long-standing ones, I'd like to take a few questions. I don't like to give a talk and then not have any discussion with the audience at all. So if we can take a break after we talk about some of the short-term patterns and some of the immediate things that adults do that reference to what happened to them as children, I'd like to take some discussion and questions, and then I'll get to the long-standing patterns. So let's look at single occurrences, and one of them is fear and panic. 36 years after the Chowchilla kidnapping, I get a call from the mother of one of the kids who was 11 years old at the time of the kidnapping. So you can say that this person is now 47 years old, and her mother calls me. Okay, and this is what she says. Her daughter runs a fitness studio for women, one of these places like Curves, or I don't know what you have in New Mexico, but there are various fitness places where women go get diet advice and also do exercises and try to stay in shape. And this is what the 47-year-old at Chowchilla has. This past summer, while the Sandusky trial was going on, two men in suits came to her fitness studio. They came all dressed up. Now, it turns out that these two men in suits were trying to effect parole for two of the kidnappers who still are sitting in jail, not having ever earned parole for what they did. And the two men in suits were trying to get the Chowchilla kids, I didn't know about this, but were trying to get them in favor of getting parole for their two out of the three. The third had been given a sentence under California juvenile statute, and he had been put on house arrest to his mother, on house parole to his mother's home that summer, and now the other two kidnappers thought they could also get out of prison. So the one kidnapper is out of prison because of the California juvenile statute, but is confined to home with his mother, has to go to everywhere with his mother, and the other two were trying to get out. And they had launched a tremendous offensive to get out. So the mother calls me because her daughter, age 47, panicked, absolutely panicked, and screamed at these guys, "You get out of my studio, I'm calling the police, I'm calling everybody, you get out of here immediately, I don't want to talk to you." And the two guys got really scared and ran out of the studio. Then afterwards, she realized who they were probably, and she was still glad that she had done that. So the mother called me to talk it over, and I told the mother, you know, this is one of the responses of strangers coming into a place that your kid does not expect them to be, just like she doesn't expect them to be coming onto her school bus. An amazing panic reaction after 36 years of not experiencing that kind of panic. Okay, second example. One of the women, the sister of the brother and sister pair who had both been sexually abused in another state by a babysitting operation, she loves to play pool. And she also buys all the groceries for her and her brother. They live together with their mother. And she needs to go to a pharmacy to pick up her medications. Suddenly, in the summer of last year, she said, "I can't go to any of those places. Someone will see me." I was concerned about what were they going to see. Well, she had a very minor skin rash on her face. And she decided that seeing the skin rash was such a vulnerability that if she went out at all, that someone would see the rash and then attack her. So that she became really fearful and panicky of a rash that she had developed. And it was because of what she had gone through as a preschooler. Now, this woman actually, in another state, when she was 16 years old, became catatonic and did not move. She had been hospitalized for a year. At that time, they would put people in the hospital for a year. And you have to realize that this was something like 25 or more years ago. But the panic and the fear and the immobility were exactly what she had done at the age of 16, and now it was coming back in her mid-40s because she had a skin rash. You could see an immediate reaction and a sudden resurgence of what had gone on in childhood. The girl who was raped last year at college by the football player, last year, toward the end of the year, she had started dating a very nice young pre-med student. And he wanted to talk everything out with her. And she said, "I won't. I can't tell anybody I'm interested in what happened to me." Now, don't forget, she didn't tell her psychiatrist at the other university. She didn't tell her parents, who really should have known what had happened to her in her first year of college. She had been a stellar student up to the point of this rape and then stopped studying, and nobody knew the reasons for any of this, and largely it was because she was sticking to this idea that she had to keep everything secret. Interestingly enough, she had terrible bruises all over her body from this rape and had gone to the police about it about 5 days after the rape occurred, and they had done a complete rape kit. They had also done all the photographs, and she had allowed that to happen. So she had an open police file on this famous football player, and she, the police wanted to prosecute him, and she was afraid to tell. She was afraid, first of all, that the whole football team would come after her, but secondly, she was afraid that he would personally somehow suffer some kind of a consequence and come after her. And so this fear of reporting had really dogged her from that time on until she had a boyfriend who was getting very disgusted because she wouldn't tell him what was going on and why she acted the way she acted. So again, we see a short, panicky response to a situation that had occurred a year before, and you're still seeing that. So beside panic and fear, you also get sudden, unexplained behaviors. And let me give you a couple of them. The woman professor whose mother had confessed to her, "I felt so terrible about what that man did to you when you were a child," and then never explained what the man did. This woman had had a number of sudden, unexplained behaviors in her life, and you know she's now well into her life. Two of them were with men that she found sexually attractive. She had suddenly panicked with these men, thinking that they were going to attack her and kill her, and so she had acted very peculiar with them, panicking and getting all behaving as though they were some kind of mashers, and those relationships had dropped immediately. But she did one thing in Munich, which was one of the craziest reenactments I've ever heard, which was that she had gone to Munich to visit some people that she knew pretty well. She'd gotten off the plane, and she was aiming to go to where they were, and a man had said, "Do you need any help?" And she had said, "Well, you could point out to me where I have to go to meet these friends of mine." He said, "Not only will I point it out, but I'll take you there." She had gone with this man, which turned out to be the end of the streetcar line in Munich, to a very deserted place. And he had turned around and raped her, and left her bleeding and dirty and full of mud all over her. And this was, even though she didn't know what had been done to her as a child, asking for it. I mean, most people know that you don't just go off with strangers. She had to get rescued then by her cousins or the people that she knew in Munich and had to be rescued. But the point of it is that she had reenacted in such a way that it was extraordinarily dangerous to her. The poet, with his seductive mother who was a prostitute, she was redheaded and Irish. In his 70s, he has chased 20-year-old redhead seductive women and tried to get them interested in him. And it is a reenactment of exactly what he went through with his mother, except that now he's trying to seduce just the opposite, a young version of his mother who he had no contact with after the age of 5. He was removed from her. So here we have again another reenactment of this guy chasing after redheaded, blue-eyed women who look Irish, who are approximately the age that his mother would have been at the time that he was picking up Johns for her. The final example I'll give you is, and these were all things that were happening at the time of the Sandusky trial, but the last one I'll give you is the case that I call Cammie, who's the wild child who I write about in the Journal of the American Academy and have followed every month. She's now 24, but this occurred last year. And last year, she was running around at her junior college with a bunch of kids who were really undesirable. I call them kids, but they were in junior college and they were in their early 20s. And they suggested that she have a date with one of them who was a definite drug dealer and with two of the other ones who were real drug involved. And last summer, she went on this date at the drug dealer's house where he was growing a lot of marijuana and going to be leaving for Las Vegas the next day to do some business. And they gave her something they called edibles, and she ate it. And at that point, several hours into this experience, she got extremely hot, she got extremely faint, she felt that she was dying. She went to lie down. She went into some kind of a coma, and she had a near-death experience in which she saw light, in which she heard an old woman singing lullabies to her, and she passed out entirely. But just before she passed out, she called her mother and said where she was and that her mother should come get her. Her mother came to this place, and these three characters did not want to give her up. They thought she was probably going to die, and they wanted to write their own cover story for her death rather than have her mother pick her up and take her out. Her mother got her out of there, and somehow she started coming to, got her home, decided not to take her to the hospital, and she gradually came out of this state and was okay after about a couple days. So whatever it was that she had was not healthy. It was probably the kind of thing that one could kill or get killed about. Her father went to pick up all of her belongings the next day, and it turned out that they didn't want to give them up because they didn't want to admit that they had had anything to do with her, so that he got into some kind of a fight with them and finally had to get all her stuff out of there. Luckily, he's a lawyer and knew exactly right words to say to get her stuff back. So those are the episodes. That's a person who, up to age 13 months, was in near-death experiences all the time. And in explaining this to her, I had to say, you were searching out exactly what you went through up to 13 months without knowing today exactly how that felt. And you wanted to feel it. You needed to feel it. You were repeating the feeling and the sensation. So, in other words, we have just covered, as far as short-term and immediate responses that you see years and years and years after childhood trauma, you can see sudden panic states, and you can also see behavioral reenactments which cause real trouble for that person. They're sudden reenactments, and they can be very self-destructive, no matter what the diagnosis is. Now, I want to take a break and ask for questions from the audience, and I know that the mics are not set up yet, so you may have to shout your question, and I will probably have to say it back into the microphone. But I'd like questions and comments from you before we go on to the next subject, which is the more long-standing and lifelong patterns that you see in people who have been traumatized as children. We have Jim Forbes here.
Jim Fawcett.
Fawcett, sorry.
Fawcett, yeah. This sounds very much like the what you see in women who are abused as children, who then pick out men who abuse them serially. They go from one man that abuses them to another. It sounds like the same reenactment you're talking about. Is that
yes,
along
and
the same lines?
You're so smart, Jim, that you are anticipating me going on to lifelong themes and lifelong patterns. Yeah. And yes, you see people who have been abused. It could be women, it could be men, who have been abused as children, who then go on to long patterns of being abused as adults. But I also have to say that some of them become violent abusers. They identify with the aggressors, and they instead go on to hurt, harm, and even kill other people who are their victims. So that it is not just it's not just the abusee who becomes the victim, but it can be the abusee who becomes the abuser.
It's easier for me to see the latter happening, but what's your formulation for the former, the seeking one abusive person after the next?
Okay, my formulation for going through it over and over again is the fact that the human brain does try to master. It's the repetition compulsion. I think that's one of the smartest things that Freud ever gave us, was the idea that people in the process of trying to master something terrible that happened repeat it again and again and again. And unfortunately, by getting abused by other men, you're actually teaching yourself that it's going to happen and that it will happen and that it's part of life and that it's what to expect. It never does correct. Most repetition compulsions, because you don't have another idea of how to get an end to it, keep you stuck in a cycle of repetitions. But if you can learn corrections, if you can learn why these kinds of things happen, what they mean, and then get some kind of mental grasp over it, including going out and meeting other groups of survivors and things like that, that will help to create a stop to the repetition compulsion. Because if you can find a correction to it, you can stop the repetition.
Thank you. This is perhaps a clarification that I'm requesting. So you've mentioned these eight cases, patients that you had been seeing for a while.
Yes.
Who, contacted you again at around the time of the Sandusky trial and verdict.
They didn't necessarily contact me again. In other words, Cammie, the wild child, I just see her on a regular basis, once a month. I've seen her since she was 3 years old. I see her regularly. The brother and the sister right now are in once a week therapy. The brother is, and the sister comes about once every 3 or 4 weeks. Part of it is medication management, but part of it is just their therapy, and that's when they were coming. So it happens to be people who showed up during the trial But they had different appointment schedules. Now, the Chowchilla mother of a Chowchilla kid, I hadn't heard from that family in something like 30-something years.
But these events that you call immediate reactions, I mean, what I gather is that you view them as reactions to whatever was happening with the Sandusky trial?
No.
Okay.
No,
then,
I don't.
I'm trying to...
In other words, the cases are not connected to Sandusky. It's just that by the timeline, they showed up at the time of Sandusky. The woman professor had started coming because she had been with a therapist who thought she was having false memories. And she just showed up in July. Now, why did she show up in July for the first time? Partly because her college was under summer break, and she had the time. She wanted to come in then.
So what makes these eight events that you've described immediate?
There's
to
a
what?
Trigger. I mean, there's an immediate trigger. What made them immediate? They're not responsive to Sandusky, as far as I know. They were people on regular schedules, or people because of their own personal schedule could come in June because school was over. The trigger that the one woman professor who came as a new patient had was that her therapist had been telling her that she was making up things, and she wanted to see another opinion and knew that I wrote about trauma and that I knew something about it. The college co-ed who showed up had seen me toward the end of that college year, and so she had started coming in about April. And the immediate trigger was that she had a new boyfriend who was insisting she get intimate with him. Verbally intimate with him, and she couldn't be verbally intimate at all ever since this rape had happened. So the immediate trigger was having a boyfriend who was insisting that she be verbally intimate. And he sounded like a reasonable boyfriend. The kid who ate the edibles was on a regular monthly schedule to see me. And I think that the edibles were available. The guy was going to Las Vegas the next day with his edibles to sell, probably. And so that happened because of that. So what happens is that you get an immediate, why were the kidnappers from Chowchilla suddenly trying to get parole last summer? I don't know if any of you saw the newspaper articles. They had a huge publicity campaign on. And, you know, I got a call from Fox News. Would I get on the news and talk about what I thought about them getting parole? And I said, no, I wouldn't say anything. I don't want to ruin a research study, even if it was done 37 years ago. So I wouldn't get involved in it. But that was going on right then, and the two guys in suits were part of that movement. More questions? Is it clear now that, you know, they're triggered by incidents that remind them of what happened, but not necessarily the Sandusky incident? I wouldn't be surprised if after the marathon bombing in Boston, that some people who've been exposed to bombings have gotten reactive and panicky. And I wouldn't be surprised in response to the Aurora Theater shootings that some people have stayed away from premieres of movies like Batman and such, so that all of us get affected by the events that are happening in our huge community, including in Norway when a guy goes and kills a bunch of kids who are different because he has political beliefs that say that nobody should immigrate into his country. I'm sure that immigrants all around the world got concerned about camps for immigrant people and such. So I think all of us are affected by those, and it's possible that a little bit of the Sandusky thing got to these people that were seeing me, but most of them were on regular schedules and had other precipitants as well. But I'm not denying that these horrible large-scale events are affecting all of us. More questions.
Do you find that when these people are traumatized, that as they age, that tends to generalize and they find themselves in other types of dangerous situations too, or that they seek out, I don't know, dangerous or fearful or scary or exciting careers even? Does that make sense?
Well, okay, let's take the career question. I don't know, you know, how many little boys who were in accidents with their families become NASCAR drivers. Somebody would have to do that study to tell us that. It'd be very interesting to know whether, if you went to the NASCAR races and you talked to these guys, how many of them have been in accidents with their families as children, or in accidents as boys with somebody. Most of them are boys. I think maybe there's one or two women who are driving NASCAR stuff now, but I don't know. It's a man's thing. But yes, I think people pick some careers, but that's not proven. It's no study has been done. How many people do sudden and unexpected reenactments? If you look at the woman professor's life, she's had three horrible incidents with men. Just three. Now she was, I urged her to talk to somebody that she knew as a child to see whether or not this person knew anything, and not to suggest to the person that there was anything going on, but to ask the person that she knew as a child whether anything had gone on in their neighborhood or such. And so she called up a person who had known her as a child in this other state where she was raised. And they had known each other prior to the age of six, because she had gone off to another place and lived somewhere else after that. And he said to her, "Well, you mean the man in our neighborhood?" And she said, "What do you mean?" And she said, "Well, all the men in our neighborhood were going to kill one of our neighbors because he was bothering children, and I don't know exactly what," said he. He had been up to 6 years old in the neighborhood and knew what it had. It was enough to say, your therapist, who said you're having totally false memories, with your mother having made this confession to you, and with this guy remembering that all the men were after somebody with their hose or whatever they were, it makes some sense that her memory has been in some way confirmed, even though it's a soft and nebulous memory. She's had three episodes. The worst was the rape in Munich. But the other two were this panic with men who were just driving her someplace, demanding to get out of the car, demanding immediately to be released, and that they were going to hurt her, and so on. So, you know, she's only had three episodes, but she has been prevented from ever having a real relationship. Does that kind of answer your questions?
Yeah, I think so. Especially she was unaware of any incident until a lot later, and she was finding herself in these horrible situations. I think that's real relevant to that question. Thank you.
Any more?
You said that the repetition compulsion behaviors, even though they serve the purpose of obtaining some mastery over the past events,
yes,
that those patterns never self-correct. So is this...
They never...
Self-correct.
That one hasn't come to an... I really believe that in trauma, you have to be able to get the feelings out. You have to be able to have some understanding of other people who've gone through this, or other places in history that this has occurred, or you have to have some understanding of how does this occur and why does it occur, and whether or not children are responsible for it. And then you have to have some sense of how it could be corrected. Mm-hmm. And once you get all of those, and you really do it, I think, with a professional person, that I think that you can go on in life and not reenact, and I think you can go in life and not have these sudden panics and fears. But whatever your diagnosis is, if you've never worked out those three processes around childhood trauma, I think there's a very good chance for a sudden and immediate reaction to things like men walking into your exercise studio with suits.
So my question is, how do you insert new material, cognitive, emotional, physical, in terms of felt emotions, so that the that ingrained pattern changes or something, there's a shift towards something
new? Well, first of all, you want to know the immediate situation and you want to talk about that. That's usually what gets the person to come back after so many years. But you also want to know the old situation, and you want to know if any other situations in their life, including what they've been told about their childhood, which they might not be able to remember at this moment because it's been masked in denial or repression or dissociation or some other defense, which has really made it sort of go away. And some of it is masked by intellectualization. They may have, you know, been taught that it doesn't mean that much and so on. You don't know. So there are a number of defenses that can make these things very obscure to people, but are there episodes in their life that were frightening or overwhelming that they think may have something to do with this episode that they've just come for? And I think usually they'll help you with it. Well, let's go on to some of the longstanding. Oh, you got one. Okay. All right.
Hi. I would like your interpretation or your observations on my observation that is every time a young woman, usually young, but I kind of see people all across the age spectrum.
Yes, anytime, most of us do, even child psychiatrists.
Yeah. Anytime a woman says to me that she has been raped, the first question I ask her is, did you tell your mother? And you would be, well, you might not be amazed, but people generally might be amazed at how many women don't tell their mothers. And then the next question, of course, is, why didn't you tell your mother? My belief is, and I'm very much into this business of being an unwanted child, because I think there's a fair amount of evidence that most people in the criminal justice system and most people who have so-called mental illnesses were not wanted children. And I would like you to comment on that, for want of a better word, fear of telling your mother that you've been sexually assaulted.
Well, that's a loaded, big, huge question. Each individual is an individual. Some people don't tell their mother because they weren't close to their mother and that they were unwanted, as you think, and that they have been somewhat neglected. And I think we all, unfortunately, are seeing more and more people who were neglected as children. Numbers of people who experience this sense of neglect and not being loved is growing. It's unfortunate. It's just a clinical observation of mine, but I think it is a growing number. But other people won't tell their mother because they've been so close, and their mother had such faith in them, and their mother thought they were so perfect, and they don't want to besmirch themselves in front of their mothers. And other people don't tell their mothers because their mother ran a department store and they don't want to lose the chance of having new dresses. I don't know, because everybody has a different relationship with their mother, and the only thing I can do is to ask each person, tell me. Now, I don't say, why didn't you tell your mother? Because why is an ugly sounding word in English. It's assaultive and it's very much like law enforcement. Why? It's one of the ugliest English sounding words. So I say things like, tell me about that, or I'm so curious about that, tell me more. Or I say things like, I'd really like to know more about that, or could you elaborate on that? Or what do you think made your mother act that way? I'd rather ask what, or what makes you act that way? I'd rather ask a what question. But better than a what question is no question at all. I'm curious, I'm wondering, I think. Any of those things, comments about yourself and that you'd like to know more, could they go on for a while? Would you like to say anything back to this?
No, it's fine.
Okay, all right. Let me go on to longstanding. So as far as longstanding occurrences that happen to people who have been traumatized, or at least the 8 going on 9 that I saw, were memory searches. Tremendous attempts to look at memory and try to understand memory and to go through very long and elaborate processes of trying to get memory back. And memory searches are very difficult for people who 36 years after the fact, or even a year after the fact, are trying to search everything in their memory to try to somehow come back to what exactly it was that happened. Charlotte, the woman who ranged the beaches of San Francisco when she was a girl during World War II, has searched all of her life, and she is now 83 years old as of last summer, blind, and suddenly gets visions of what happened. Now, am I supposed to believe these visions or go along with these visions? I know that people who become totally blind do get visions. And that not only was she going totally blind, but she was starting to lose some of her memory. And now she tells me with great elaboration, I can only talk to her on the telephone now because she can't come to the office any longer. She can't get there. And in a phone interview, she tells me that she remembers an amusement park in Alameda, California, which was across the bay from where she lived, and that she had scratched her bottom on a slide there because it was rusty and that the amusement park was empty, and that a man offered to put ointment on her bottom. Now, that is very possible, but it is also possibly not. And I can't say that that kind of a memory search is accurate, inaccurate, helpful, unhelpful. I just know that at 83, a person is obsessing about being 3 years old on a beach. If you want to know more about Charlotte and her life, I begin Too Scared to Cry, a book that I wrote with her story. And she has been a fascinating patient. She was my first patient when I moved to San Francisco in 1971. We sat at a bridge table because I didn't even have furniture in my office. And she came because her mother had died and she felt she lost her last protection in life. Her mother was the kind of person she felt could be a protection to her. And she believed all of her life that if her mother had been with her on the beach, that these things would not have happened to her. But her reason for coming for psychotherapy in her 40s was that her mother had died suddenly, unexpectedly. It was probably a heart death. And she came for that reason, and I followed her for the rest of her life. And as I say, child psychiatrists don't always do child psychiatry, but we're always looking at what could have been the beginning seeds of a person's life. And in her case, I think it was one of the seeds. Now, at this point, I cannot say whether this memory search is worth it. In a way, I wish she wouldn't have to spend that kind of time searching through her own memory and her own visions for what she thinks could or might have happened to her. The professor. I told you that what precipitated her coming to my office was a memory search. A therapist had told her there were such things as false memories. She had read up a whole bunch of literature on false memories. She didn't know whether her memories were false. We discussed together at that time in June whether or not there was a way to check with anybody else. Her mother was dead. Her mother had told this to her many years before. It was such a shame that all this happened to you as a child. So it was our idea that she called the childhood friend. It's still my idea that she go back to the childhood place and try to look at the houses, and maybe even go with her friend. She has not had the nerve to do it yet. She's on a memory search. I suggested if she wanted to, I don't do any hypnosis, but if she wanted to go to somebody who does very ethical kinds of hypnosis, we've got Dave Spiegel down in Stanford, who does a very ethical kind of hypnosis, and I called David. Would he see the professor? Oh, yes, he would see the professor, and the professor has not yet ventured there. So that you try to think of what in your community might be a way that the person could come to some understanding about their memory, but you cannot provide a memory to them. All you can do is leave them with their shards, whatever shards they can come up with, and that's it. So all I can say is that she was driven into treatment because she had been treated by, after Munich, she had been treated by a believer in false memory, and that it was just an episode. The 20-year-old rape victim, interestingly enough, cannot remember the whole rape. She knows that the police own photographs of all the bruises on her body. She remembers the death threats. She cannot remember everything this guy said to her. He was calling her all kinds of names, and she can't remember which particular names he was calling her. And interestingly enough, she, in her attempt in June and July to try to negotiate a relationship with this pre-med student who wanted one with her, she had decided, and I found this very interesting, she had decided in June that she would go to the police and turn him in and let them go at him. Now, you know, she had much more than a year statute of limitation. She could have gone at any point. Did she go to the police because of Jerry Sandusky? You know, it's a good question. Did she then decide she was going to correct for this? But she was repeating it so much, and she was going through such a memory search that she wanted to see whether or not they would pick up on the story now, a year after the fact. And I thought it was fair enough. It was a type of correction. It was an attempt to get on top of a situation that she had totally lost out on. And even though she was having a memory search and she felt that it would be inadequate to go to the police with, that they would find her inadequate, I said that anybody would defend themselves this way from a horrible experience like this, and that they had the goods because they had all these pictures and they had their rape kit and they had all of those findings. So I don't know what they finally did with it. I have not seen her in a while. But her determination to do something about it, I found very interesting. And that may have been Sandusky connected. It's very possible that seeing that he was going to go to jail and that he had finally been caught and taken down might have done that for her. Interesting about memory, the brother and the sister who were sexually abused in the same babysitting setup in their state, the brother remembers almost nothing of it. The sister remembers every detail of it. That two people from the same family, same genetic basis, same parents, same everything. One remembers nothing, the other remembers everything. Have they fed each other the information? No, they never talk about it. They can't talk about it. The girl who remembered everything became catatonic and does nothing, freezes in paralysis. The guy who remembers nothing goes out to bars looking for women who are victims. And then he tries to rescue them. And he spends his whole life trying to rescue victims that he meets in bars. Neither has married. Both live together and both pay the price for what happened to them. Which brings us to life themes, which I think is the most damaging and scary part of this whole thing of having been hurt as a child or traumatized as a child. Life themes. The brother's women are all victims. The brother's women are all way below his intellectual functioning and not worthy of really being able to be partners with him. They're all women who have been harmed. Now, in this group babysitting thing, he thinks. And from some of his behavior in elementary school, I think it's true. He thinks that he was made to have baby sex with girls in the babysitting operation. His sister, who went through it 5 years later and remembers everything, said that was group sex and that these people, these adults, were watching kids set up to do things with each other. The boy feels terribly guilty that he didn't rescue his sister, and he feels terribly guilty that he didn't rescue the little girls in this babysitting place. He thinks that somehow he should have been able to get them out of their miseries. And in elementary school, he knew one of the little girls who had been in babysitting with him, and he thinks she died. And he doesn't know this, but she disappeared from the elementary school. Now, this guy was so busy being a genius that he disappeared from elementary school by going off to college by the time he was 14 and getting his PhD when he was 17 or something like that. So this is a real genius guy. Maybe he disappeared and the girl was still there. I don't know. But again, I can't confirm or deny to him what happened to the girl. He doesn't remember her name. He remembers what she looked like. And he can't get any further with it. But this thing, this life theme of having to rescue unfortunate women has kept this genius from being able to multiply and create three new geniuses on the world, and you know, that's a shame. The poet's women. The poet has been writing an epic poem about the women of strip clubs of San Francisco. It's an epic. It goes on and on and on. I have read it once and pronounced it a good poem, and that wasn't good enough. I read a newspaper article just recently that this poem is still being completed, this epic. It's like Homer's Odyssey, going from strip club to strip club, looking at various women who are in terrible trouble and picking up on men and lap dancing and doing all this stuff. And his life theme is to chase this down. I mean, it's been going on for 2-3 years. He's writing this epic. I think it is a type of odyssey. It is a Homeric kind of thing. If the guy was a lousy poet, I would say, you know, but he's not. But it's becoming, like a life work. And the question is, do you want to have your life work based on some old chasing down of something that happened to you? Or do you want to go on from there and write a poem about vegetable gardens? I don't know. But again, I I'm not trying to be funny about it exactly, although I try to be funny. It becomes the story of a person's 3-4 year pursuit, and that's a life theme. Then there are lives of avoidance, which becomes a life theme. The professor, the sister, Charlotte, the child of the beach. None of them have married. None of them have children. None of them have really risked a relationship with a man or a woman. And interestingly, I asked the professor's getting on in age, and I asked her whether she goes to a gynecologist. No. Has she ever had a gynecological exam? No. Does she intend to have periodic gynecological exams to make sure she doesn't get cancer? No. I'd rather die of cancer than be examined by a doctor. So you wonder about medical avoidances as a life theme, and this is one. Very knowledgeable person, very educated person, knows the risk, would rather make that risk than the risk of having the discomfort of going to a doctor, even a woman. And look at all the gynecologists today who are women. Even so. Finally, the ninth, and I'll just give you this as a life theme. The hero of Chowchilla, 14-year-old boy who dug them all out, became a rodeo rider. He became a professional rodeo person and got involved in the drug culture of rodeos and became a drug addict. had a child who was removed from him and was taken permanently, the rights were taken away from him, has been in and out of rehab places. This is another entirely different state, and I can't do much for this guy because he is outside the state, and I'm also not allowed to do certain kinds of interventions as a regular psychiatrist, and you have to have special permissions in California to do various things about drugs. At any rate, I get a call during the Sandusky time last summer from him, and he said, I just need you to respond to something. And I said, okay, what is it? Thinking he wants drugs, or he, you know, I'm gonna have to tell him no. He said, I've been clean and sober for 13 months, and I celebrated my 1 year anniversary in AA. And he said, I'm getting something out of it, and I'm really gonna stay clean. And I said, this is just a wonderful thing to hear from you. I think it's just absolutely great. And he said, thanks a lot, and he hung up. Now that was Chowchilla that I hadn't heard from in ages. And I just thought it was so interesting right at that moment, congratulate me, I'm 13 months. And you know, you have to lay it on. I mean, really, congratulations, that is wonderful. So I'll end this on a somewhat upbeat tone, trying to see now whether or not we've got 20 minutes for questions, whether or not you have questions about long-standing effects that I saw in my 8 going on 9 because of Bob of Chowchilla. How many of you have a comment about this? And I'm hoping that we get some good comments. Oh, I shouldn't have said that. I'll make you all shy again. Do I see a questioner down here? Okay, there we go.
Yes, how about the attachment, the effect on attachment? It sounds, I mean, what's the difference between the fear of a relationship such as a sexual relationship or an intimate relationship and the inability to even form attachments with other people? Do you see any difference in people who are abused as young children by parental figures versus people who are abused later in terms of attachment effects?
Sex is very specific as sex, and people who have been sexually bothered in various ways have very specific literal problems about sex that that go along with sex. On top of that, you have the family betrayals of things that go on in families. And those are breaks in the family relationship, because a betrayal in a family where a person expects trust is very, very serious. And I have always taken the position that attachment outweighs trauma. I think that attachment is so important. The sense of trust in parents and family becomes translated into a sense of belonging in the University of New Mexico. I don't know you, but I trust you, because I've been raised in a trusting environment. And I understand that, and so I trust you. I don't expect that you're going to attack me or do things to me which are going to be betrayals. But that being said, a person who is specifically abused inside of a family will repeat those kinds of abuses in some kind of way. And Cammy, who was bitten and shaken, her sister was bitten and shaken to death. She was bitten and shaken and sexually abused all at once. She, for the longest time, would shake herself, would shake animals almost to the point of death, shook and squeezed a gerbil that she was bringing to school so that it did die and they had to bury it. And repeated specifically and literally shaking and biting and scratching. She'd scratch herself raw. So that those are literal repetitions that are specific to the trauma aside from the betrayal. Now when Cammy turned to be 12 or 13, I can't remember exactly the age, her father murdered another child that he was involved in a family with. And her big question was, am I too a murderer? Will I become a murderer? And we had to work on that for the longest time. That kind of betrayal to someone else, even though it wasn't her family, it was still her father. And genetically, she had a question, and actually experientially, she had a question, both. And it was very difficult to work it out. We did get it worked out. We got a question way back there.
Hey, thanks, Lenore. So I'm just curious, in your experience, when you're working with people who have been traumatized, in child psychiatry, we're trying to shift maybe a focus sometimes on resilience or protective factors. And you're kind of describing some developmental fields where we're kind of seeing adults fail to thrive in certain developmental fields in their life. And can you comment on sort of what you've seen in your work in terms of what might give people certain resilience factors to be able to stop the repetition or kind of grow out of those cycles?
I don't think people just kind of grow out of this stuff. This is Nate, way back there, child fellow. I spent my morning in delight with the child fellows. They're so good here, and you guys should be proud. I think you have to specifically work on the kind of trauma that the person had, beside expecting their resiliency to take over and just look at the brother in this brother-sister combo who went off to college by the time he was around 14. He was a math whiz. He won every math contest that anybody could possibly win. He could do anything in mathematics in his head. Shouldn't that give him enough sense of being Mr. Strong and brave that he doesn't have to take all these pitiful girls into his life? Can't he get married and be resilient? You know, he's a math whiz. No. He needed to work it out anyway. You can't expect people to be able to work out superhuman situations that descend on them. You have to give them help. And the sooner you give them help, the better. But even so, they may need another dose of help. I was telling the residents about a little boy who was kidnapped when he was two at gunpoint from his mother. And when he was two, he didn't realize his mother could be shot and killed. When he was two, he thought that the man was taking him out for a Coke and that his mother had voluntarily given him up. And he was terribly disappointed in his mother for sending him off with this very bad man who he didn't like and who was just trying to give him a Coke. But by the time he came to see me at eight, and he was brought from another state, and he was brought for just a few times so that I could see him, and then he went home to his state, he said to me, now I realize that the man could have shot my mother. And he said, so now I'm not afraid of losing my mother. Now, he said, I'm afraid of death and dying and shooting and guns. So that the entire thing looked different according to cognitively where he had finally gotten. But you can think that somebody's resilient in overcoming it and that he's been rescued by the FBI, which he was, and that the ransom was not paid, which it wasn't. And you can think all that, but at the same time, this person is going through new development and new thoughts and new knowledge. And maybe if he had been at that time in Aurora, would have experienced the Colorado shooting very indirectly. But those are things that affect people when they happen. And all of us get different outlooks on them at various times in our lives. The guy who was kidnapped for ransom became a financial analyst on Wall Street and happened to be in the World Trade Center the day that the bombing happened. And he got out okay. He was on one of the lower floors and he got out okay. And his mother, now an older person, called me up and said, do you think you should talk to him? And I said, if he calls me, I will talk to him for a whole hour. We'll make an appointment and we'll talk. He never did. So he felt, he must have felt, that he got through the World Trade Center okay. Or maybe he went to see a psychiatrist there in New York. There are plenty of them. So I don't really know what the eventual outcome was, but that was another phone call from a mother. Do you think it would be a good idea? Of course it's a good idea if he wants to. But it's still up to him. Yes?
What happened to the Chowchilla 8? It was a study.
The Chowchilla 26?
Yes, the 26. That's right.
Okay. What happened to them was that they remained what I consider traumatized at the 4 to 5 year mark. And that one of the things that I discovered then was that they had a very poor sense of the future. And that became futurelessness and DSM and all the DSMs that have followed. And is that traumatized people really don't count on their futures, but kids count on their futures. And so that to be a well-adjusted kid, you really have to have a sense of future. I always ask patients about their futures and how they envision them, even when they're 83 years old and blind. How do you see your future now? What are you gonna, how are you gonna pursue your future? I still see the future as an open-ended question, and it's a what and how question, not why, but it's a what and how question. How do you envision it?
Did any of them went on to have long-term loving relationships or not?
The Chowchilla kids? They married, and you know, what I hear informally, they weren't marriageable ages when I did the 4 to 5 year follow-up. They were 5 to 14 years old at the time I did it. And by the time the 4 to 5 year follow-up came, I had to go chase some of them down in very far away places. And I wondered if I should do another one, but I was running all over the country seeing, I mean, people in America scatter. And so it was too expensive, time consuming, and I wasn't sure what kind of intervening events and how I would assess those, and how would I ever bring in a comparison group at a much later date. I had a comparison group from McFarland in Porterville, California for the 4 to 5 year study, and I matched girls with girls and ages with ages, and it was all done with a statistician, and it worked out. But to do that at 20 years, it's just a headache, a real headache. I don't know if it could have been done. It would have been nice to do it, but I don't think I could have done it. I don't think I could have gotten a grant big enough to do it. It was a good study. I'm still fond of it. Yes?
How would you characterize your approach to treating childhood trauma in adults?
How would I characterize my approach to treating childhood trauma in adults? With humor, sometimes with play. The professor is in bibliotherapy with me. That's what she calls it. We read articles together on trauma, and we talk about them, and we talk about where it fits in with her life. We've been doing this approximately once a month because she can't come in any regular time except during the summers. And this has only been it's not quite a summer yet. I mean, a year since I began working with her, so I've probably had 7 bibliotherapy sessions with her. The idea is abreaction, context, and correction. And I work on all three of these. Is the emotional expression of it, the thinking expressions and understandings together, and any ways that this can be corrected. Even in fantasy. You know, I also treat their depressions. I give them medication. I do what has to be done about their depressions. What other conditions they have, we treat. And I don't say that childhood trauma is their only condition or even their most important condition, but we don't ignore the trauma and we do work on the trauma. I wish, now I'm fantasizing, but I wish every adult psychiatrist could get a little child psychiatry, because I just think that the child is the father of the man. But that's just a wish. It's not going to happen. And a lot of general psychiatrists look at child psychiatrists as being children or little people or something.
child psychiatrists have an extra year of training, and they are working with some of the most difficult situations that the world could ever conceive. And they're harder to work on than adults, because a lot of times you have to work entirely in metaphor or in play or in some other avenue so that you can get them to trust and talk to you, and so that you can actually talk about what goes on in their lives. And they respond to tales, and they respond to art, and they respond to playing with something. But you have to be very clever and sort of, it's like Yogi Berra said, you know, when you come to a fork in the road, take it. With children, yeah, you come to a fork in the road and you have to take it. You always keep in the back of your mind, do no harm, but you take the forks and you go with them. Got 5 minutes left. Yes?
Given what it seems to me to be fairly convincing experimental evidence about the ease with which memories can be manipulated or created, what's the best way to avoid having cultural tropes, shall we say, being introduced into a memory search when someone's doing it?
Well, I don't particularly like fads. Some of you may be doing EMDR. I think it's okay to relax a person. I don't see the anatomical basis for it. I don't understand why it theoretically works to snap your fingers against a baby's head and then do something for that baby. But at the same time, if you're using one of these, just keep thinking about rules of psychotherapy and theories of psychotherapy and other ways of considering psychotherapy that may seem old-fashioned, but that have been proven over the years to be helpful to lots and lots of people. I don't know, there have always been fads in psychiatry, especially because people don't want to go to psychiatrists. And now, with the NRA saying that everybody should have some kind of psychiatric profile and that psychiatrists are able to tell who's going to attack a school, and we have a situation where nobody can tell because it's unpredictable. It's an unpredictable situation. So that with everybody saying you should go to a psychiatrist to see if you're going to do these things, nobody will go to a psychiatrist, because the idea is that psychiatrists will be keeping these records that can be then used against you and can be turned in to keep you from having a gun or whatever else you want to have. So that the idea of using psychiatry in this way is going to really kill psychiatry if it goes through. We can't predict. We're no good at predicting. We never said we were any good. Tarasoff rules as far as warning family or warning the police department that so-and-so is looking suicidal, sure. The rules of commitment, to commit somebody, if there's a place to commit them to, certainly if they're dangerous to themselves or others, those rules are, if you know as a psychiatrist that at this moment they are, you're going to do that. You're going to try the hardest that you can to do that. But Cho, the killer of all those kids at Virginia Tech, his psychiatrist tried to commit him, wrote dangerous to himself and depressed. The judge who heard the Cho commitment case said, that's not a diagnosis, I don't go with that, and he let him out. And anyway, the person didn't predict that Cho was going to kill everybody at Virginia Tech. All he said was he was going to kill himself. So that psychiatrist never knew that Cho was going to do what Cho did. You can't make a profile of these people. There is one mass killer of children who's a woman who's Jewish. Her name was Lori Dann, D-A-N-N. You can look her up. She was in Chicago. She tried to kill kids in two elementary schools, try to send them poison by mail, various other kids. She tried to light a fire and a bomb in one school, and she tried to shoot a bunch of kids in the other school and did successfully shoot about 3 dead. But they're not the same. They're not all men. They're not all white, Cho being Asian.
They're not all bad actors. The Texas Tower killer was a Marine, honorably discharged from the Marines, no psychiatric record at all, and yet he knew he was going to be killed up in the tower by some Texas Ranger or somebody, and so he left a note up there, and it said, "When you autopsy me, check my brain. I think there's something wrong with it." He never would have gone to a psychiatrist, but he would have gone to a brain doctor if he knew of one. So these people don't all show up at psychiatrists, nor do they show up at the neurologist's office. Well, it is exactly 2:30. I have really enjoyed being here. I've enjoyed your questions. I think you're a really good audience. I love the place. And thank you so much for being attentive and great with me. And thanks for all your hospitality while I was here. Thank you all.